Christ, be with us now as we come together to worship. Warm welcome to everyone, those who are joining us at home as well. You're very much part of this morning. Thank you too to Harry and to Stephen, who's on sound today. Our call to worship. Thinking we know all the answers, yet wondering if we haven't missed something, we enter this time of worship. In the company of sinners, in the company of saints, we gather as God's people. Sitting beside people of deep faith, sitting with those who stumble through the kingdom, we lift our praise to God. Lord of all beings, throned afar. Crafted from love, you hang justice and peace on your tool belt. You take on rebuilding neighbourhoods when we would walk away. What have you to do with us, Holy God? You model compassion for us. You take us by the hand to lift us to our feet. You show us the path which leads to humility. You leave a trail of grace crumbs so that we might follow. What have you to do with us, brother of the poor? You call us to serve by your side. You plant words of peace deep into our hearts. You raise up little children to whisper hope to us. You stand by the side of all who look for life. What have you to do with us, Spirit of Grace? You teach us how to build up others with love. Though we think we know it all, Our lives reflect how little we respect others, how often our words and actions damage those around us. Let us come to God with our prayers as well as our hearts, so we may be healed with forgiveness. God, our God, we fill our souls with the empty sounds of our culture and wonder why we're so empty when we need words of hope, of grace, of comfort. We're careful to follow the prescriptions our doctors give us, yet pay little heed to your hopes for us. We puff out our chests over what good people we are, yet do not notice how our pride trips those who seek to follow Jesus. Forgive us, Holy One, and be gracious to us. Astound us with your words, so we may learn your ways. Nourish us with your mercy, so we may be filled with life. Enter our empty souls till they overflow with praise for you, Son Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory for ever and ever. Amen. So we turn now to Hebrew scripture in the Psalms, Psalm 111, God's word for us.
Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of honour and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has gained renown by his wonderful deeds. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. Amen, and thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Once upon a time, long, long ago, a man had car trouble near a monastery. He knocked on the door and he tells the monk, "My car's broken down, can I spend the night here?" They receive him with great hospitality, they give him a wonderful dinner and even fix his car, and then they show him to a guest room for the night. He's just about to fall asleep and he hears a very strange sound. It's a sound like nothing he's ever heard. It's a sound that draws him towards it. He can't sleep, wondering where that sound's coming from and what can be making it. The next morning he asks the monks, "What's that sound I heard last night?" They reply, "We can't tell you, you're not a monk." The man leaves, but he can't forget that sound, and years later he returns and pleads with them to tell him. Again they refuse, "We can't tell you, you're not a monk." He demands, "Well then, tell me how I can become a monk." And they answer him, "You must travel the earth and tell us how many blades of grass there are and the exact numbers of grains of sand. When you find these answers, you will become a monk." The man sets out to complete the assignment, and after years of searching, he returns a very grey-haired old man. He knocks on the door of the monastery. A monk answers. He's taken before the gathering of all the monks, and this is what he said. "In my quest to find what makes that beautiful sound, I travelled the earth and have found the answer to what you asked for. By design, the world is in a state of perpetual change. Only God knows what you ask. All we can do is know ourselves, and that requires that we're honest and reflective and willing to strip away all self-deception. Well done, the monks reply, you're now a monk, and we shall now show you the way to the mystery of the sacred sound. They lead the man to a wooden door where the head monk says, the sound is beyond that door. The monk gives him a key to the stone door, only to find a door made of ruby. And so it went, as he needed keys to doors of emerald, pearl and diamond. And finally, they come to a door made of solid gold. The sound has become very clear and definite. The monks say, this is the last key to the last door. The man's so excited and anxious. He's lived his life desiring to discover the source of that beautiful, captivating, seductive sound. With trembling hands, he unlocks the door, turns the knob, and slowly pushes the door open. Falling to his knees, he's utterly amazed to discover the sound of that haunting sound. But I can't tell you, because you're not a monk. My title for my thoughts today in this psalm is A Beginner's Course in Theology. There are two ways to talk about God. One is information that can be regurgitated on an exam. The other way of talking about God is confessional. It's not information, but transformation. To know who God is requires living consciously in relationship with God through Jesus Christ. The person who wrote Psalm 111 is rooted in his belief in a God who provides and blesses and protects. And the psalmist bases his life journey on his faith. Many people come to church believing that the church can give them answers, that they can only get the right knowledge, they'll have what they're searching for. Wrong. What they're looking for is not knowledge, but faith. And faith is about betting your life on a God whose promises are trustworthy. And the only way to know they are trustworthy is to risk living by them. Knowledge can be distance learning. Faith goes down to the very core of our being. It entails surrender. God can be trusted to keep God's promise, never to abandon, desert, or forsake us. God can be trusted to redeem, reclaim, recover, restore, and recreate all that God loves. A wee girl was flying her kite on a windy March day. The dark clouds were hanging so low, and she'd let out so much string that her kite had disappeared in the clouds. A man came along and asked what she was doing. She said, I'm flying my kite. I don't see it, he said. You can't see it. How do you know it's there? She answered, every so often it tugs at me. We feel the tug. We hear the sound that so captivates us that we want to know its source. We have this sense that something is missing in us that we cannot provide ourselves, so we set out to discover it. And the good news is that we have been held by it, embraced by it all along. Now, it takes us a while to trust in the God whose covenant, the psalmist professes, is commanded forever. We try to fill our God-shaped hole with lesser gods, with idols that eventually disappoint us. They disappoint us because we made them. We have this need for security. We think we can remove the anxiety of our impermanence by hiding in what we've declared as permanent. We do it with our understandings of God and God's will. We do it with how we do church. We do it with the ways we worship. We inherit or develop ways of worship that we can find meaningful, and then we say they're eternal. They can't be changed. The fact is that what exists today exists due to a change in what once existed. A beginner's course in theology is based on faith in a God who is trustworthy. This God is with us through the passages of life. The truth is that all of life is a passage, it's movement. And even though we debate about whether we want change or not, the reality is change is constant. An issue is not whether we want change, but what kind of change it will be. Just look in the mirror. We cannot stop life where we want it and build a wall round us to keep it that way. The covenant that God has commanded forever is that God is with us, redeeming us, renewing the earth, recreating creation. When we live in the fear that we'll settle for less than what God wants for us, we hear the psalmist assert, that is the beginning of wisdom. We don't believe that God causes everything that happens. What kind of God would cause children to die in a house fire, or a fatal disease to strike a young mother, or a hurricane to wipe out hundreds of homes? What we can believe in is that the God who has commanded God's covenant forever is with us no matter what happens. God has not forsaken us. God wills that good comes from bad. The cross above the pulpit is to remind us that God can be trusted to be at work salvaging good from every human experience. Divine love, self-sacrificing love, is at work. It never ever ends. From bondage in Egypt to exile in Babylon to Good Friday, and as we go through every life stage, every passage, as individuals, as a nation, as a church, God is with us. We are not alone. We are part of creation's renewal, and God invites us to trust the promise and become God's partners in that covenantal conspiracy. Great blessings can come out of moments of deepest despair. It is the thankful heart that can, with Paul, say, I've learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. It all depends on how you look at life. Two men looked out from prison bars. The one saw the mud, and the other the stars. Perhaps Edwin Markham best gathers it all up in that unforgettable verse. On the bough of the rose is the prickling briar. The delicate lily must live in the mire. The hues of the butterfly go at a breath. At the end of the road is the house of death. Nay, nay, on the briar is the delicate rose. In the mire of the river, the lily grows. The moth is as fair as a flower of the sod. At the end of the road is a door to God. Psalm 111 is full of praise. Of course, there are many times when we don't feel like praising. And the book of Psalms allows us to express every possible human emotion. But there's something strangely life-changing when we are able, as the old hymn says, to count our blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise us what the Lord has done. It doesn't remove our struggle or hurt or anger completely, but gives us a chink of light in the darkness. Maybe even an inkling of the source of the sacred sound. We reflect on that as we listen to Majesty.
Thank you.
turn again to God's word, this time in the New Testament, in the Gospel of Mark, Mark 1 at verse 21.
They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. Amen, and thanks be to God.
For centuries, people believed that Aristotle was right when he said that the heavier an object, the faster it would fall to the earth. Aristotle was regarded as the greatest thinker of all time, and surely he would not be wrong. Anyone, of course, could have taken two objects, one heavy and one light, and dropped them from a great height to see whether or not the heavier object landed first, but no one did until nearly 2,000 years after Aristotle's death. Legend has it that in 1589, Galileo summoned learned professors to the base of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Then he went to the top and pushed off a 10-pound and a 1-pound weight. Both landed at exactly the same instant. However, people denied what they saw. The power of belief was so strong, they continued to say that Aristotle was right. This past Wednesday was Holocaust Memorial Day. I watched a program presented by David Baddiel on Holocaust deniers. I found it incredible and shocking that people believe that it didn't happen. A bit like what has happened in the United States, people claiming that the election result was rigged. Most people are going to believe what they've always believed, regardless of the facts. But something different occurred in the life of Jesus, something persuasive. Mark records that when Jesus came to Capernaum on the Sabbath day and entered the synagogue and taught, the crowds were astounded. Why? One word: authority. He taught not as the scribes taught, but as one having authority. What was it that convinced them? What did they hear and see in the life of Christ that made him stand above all other teachers? Why were they so drawn to him? First, his teaching was new. It was new because Jesus moved from past tense to present tense. If you've ever taken a tour of the Holy Land, one of the places you'll visit is the ancient ruins of the city Capernaum. It's the fishing town that Jesus made his headquarters while he was in Galilee. It was Peter's hometown. What's remarkable is that you can go there today and see the walls of a small first century home. The home has been identified since the time of Constantine as Peter's house. 100 feet from the front door of his home are the remains of the synagogue of Jesus. Standing there with the winds of the Sea of Galilee blowing through the ruins, you can just picture Jesus and Peter walking up, waking up on the Sabbath, walking across the street with the rest of the disciples and attending services. Because this is Peter's home synagogue, he probably had something to do with Jesus being invited to teach. It's a place where he taught regularly. For a period of time, he was there every week in the synagogue teaching as a visiting rabbi. And as he began to teach, Mark tells us, the people were amazed. What amazed them is that when Jesus stood up to teach, he didn't say, "Moses has taught us," or "the Exodus teaches us," or "the prophet Isaiah reminds us," or "Rabbi so-and-so has said." No. When he stood up in the synagogue there in Peter's hometown, he said, "I say to you." All the other rabbis told the people to offer a sacrifice at the temple for the remission of sins, but Jesus said to people directly, "Your sins are forgiven." The rabbis all encouraged people to believe in God. Along comes Jesus and he tells them, believe in God, believe also in me. The difference was astonishing. All the other rabbis got their authority from quoting the scriptures and talking about the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. They referenced the rabbis before them to support their positions, but Jesus, here was something completely new. He was the authority. I am the door, I am the vine, I am the gate, I am the good shepherd, I am the light of the world. His teachings echoed with something new, something astonishing. God was no longer in the past, God was in the present, in the life of Jesus of Nazareth. And that brings up the second reason why people were so drawn to him. He taught with authority. It was obvious to the synagogue that day that Jesus was a teacher of a different order because he didn't quote the authorities of the past. He was that authority himself. That was the first clue that something new was happening, but then something happened right in their midst that stunned them, made them sit up and take notice. He backed up what he taught with action. It may have been on Jesus' very first visit to the synagogue, in the middle of his teaching, that a man with an evil spirit interrupted him. Jesus then demonstrated the authority of his teaching with his power over the spirits. If we look at what happened, the first thing to notice is the man didn't burst into the synagogue disrupting the service. Mark tells us that this was a man within their synagogue, probably a respected layperson and a productive member of society. The synagogue leaders would not permit any other kind. A second thing to notice is that this man's affliction is only identified as an evil spirit. The demon isn't tied to any kind of sickness. What then was this demon doing to this man? We can't say for sure, but I'd say that the demon's influence in this case was more of a moral nature. I don't know what moral issue this man had, but it was tearing him up. What do you think it was? You could pick one. A demon of hate, revenge, perverted sex, unbridled lust for power, uncontrolled greed, distorted ambition, fear, guilt, envy, jealousy. Or perhaps it was the demon of lust, negativism, slander, revenge, deceit, greed, gossip. Which one? These demons are all around us, and uncontrolled, these demons will destroy life. A third thing to notice is this man had given authority to this demon. He was possessed by it. The demon had gained control and he'd lost control. And Paul reminds us that the chief demon himself, Satan, is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. There are authorities and teachings in this world that you can use to try and overpower these demons. You can turn to education, sociology, history, philosophy or psychology, even religion. And all these things have a certain kind of power, but not the power of Jesus. Other teachings have authority, but not the authority of Jesus' new teaching. What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? The evil spirit asks. I know who you are, the Holy One of God. The demon is not even addressed. He acknowledges of his own accord that one with a greater authority has arrived. Be quiet, Jesus speaks sternly. Come out of him. The evil spirit shook the man violently and came out with a shriek. Now notice this last thing, the people were amazed. Something new, something astonishing had just happened. The authority of God was occurring before their very eyes. Like watching Moses part the Red Sea or watching the walls of Jericho fall, the power of God was present. What is this, they asked. A new teaching and with authority. He even gives orders to evil spirits and they obey him. Education can make us intelligent. Sociology can give us cultural knowledge. History can give us world knowledge. Philosophy teaches us conceptual knowledge. Science teaches us the natural laws. Psychology offers behavioral knowledge. Religion imparts divine knowledge. But in the end, all of these do not have the authority to control the demons that can take control of any one of us. We need something more, a new teaching, something with authority. Most of us, when we think about the presence of absolute evil in the world, think of the leaders of the Nazis in Germany in World War II. Hannah Arendt was a German-American philosopher and political theorist until her death in 1975. She'd been born into a secular Jewish home in Germany but escaped to the United States in 1941. 2 decades later, Arendt, as a journalist for the New Yorker magazine, covered the trial in Israel of Adolf Eichmann, a committed Nazi leader who helped Hitler carry out the Holocaust. From Arendt's experience, she penned a book titled Eichmann in Jerusalem, in which she spoke of the banality of evil, words contained in the subtitle. The popular view was the Nazi murderers were psychopathic, bloodthirsty monsters. Yet, as Arendt observed Eichmann and listened to his defense before the Israeli court, she was struck by his apparent moral neutrality. He seemed not to be anti-Semitic, but ordinary. The Holocaust, she wrote for the Jews, was quite literally the end of the world. But for Eichmann, it was nothing more than a job, with daily routine and its ups and downs. To me, that is more frightening than to say he was a psychopath. Because if ordinary people can, under the right conditions, become monsters, which truly happened in Nazi Germany, then all of us are potentially susceptible. That's why we should be careful about how much passion we allow ourselves in taking up controversial causes. Ordinary people can only too easily be swept up into doing awful things by a demagogue with simple but mistaken beliefs. Let's not allow the drama of this encounter in Mark to blind us to what is really happening here. Jesus saw a man who needed help, and he gave that help, just as he has helped millions since. Paul Tournier was a brilliant thinker and writer, and an influential Christian therapist during his time. Doctors from around the world traveled to his home in Switzerland to learn from him. He wrote, "It's a little embarrassing for students to come over and study my techniques. They always go away disappointed, because all I do is accept people." That's what Jesus does for people. He accepts them. It makes no difference who they are or what they've done. He accepts them. And if they will trust him, really trust him, he's willing to deliver them, heal them, quiet their spirit, and make them whole again. I don't know what each one of us is struggling with, but do you believe that Jesus wants to help you, whatever your need is? Are you willing to trust him? Amen. And now to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be the glory now and forever. Amen. We cannot measure how you heal.
Thank you.
So now is our moment of offering, our time to give all we have, all we are, our very lives back to God. Glory be to God the Father. Of our mortal, we offer our respect and our love. For the love which draws all things to their fulfillment, for forms of life known and unknown, for relationships through which life is given form, in which life is nurtured and nourished, by which is alone life can achieve its potential. We offer our conscious commitment. For a spirit in and around us, energizing our lives, offering to us the journey of faith, teaching us daily to find the creator, the lover, and the mover in each other, prompting us to step out of our straitjackets and flow in the freedom of your love, we offer our praise and our service. Hear us as we pray for those who have no eye for beauty, no comprehension of mystery, no recognition of possibilities beyond human boundary. For the skeptic who rightly asks their questions, for the throng person who refuses to budge. We pray for those who have no sense of love other than their own satisfaction, those who place no value on relationships for others that are there to be used, those who give nothing of themselves, who then cannot receive from those who would give. For those who rely solely upon themselves, for those whose resources are limited, for those who cannot or will not open themselves to mystery, who are content in a world of their own, whose security is bound by rules, who are imprisoned by their own ideology. By your creative spirit, given to all through Jesus Christ, open the doors of possibility for all of us. There are many who find life unbearable, the deeply distressed and depressed, those in overwhelming and unrelenting pain, those racked with guilt and fear. Grant release to those who suffer and bring them comfort in the knowledge of your acceptance and recreating and restoring forgiveness. Comfort all who cry out silently behind locked doors for opportunity and hope and encouragement with the awareness of your presence with them. Grant once again the frail and the fragile, the elderly and those incapacitated, with a powerful sense of thanksgiving for all their experience of life as your children. Sustain them in the days ahead with the knowledge that they can trust you and rest easily in faith in your love, knowing that nothing in life or death can separate them from your care and love. We commend and commit to your care and keeping those whom we now name in the silence, in the secret place of our hearts. Be to each and to all the God of their need this day, and may that peace, which is Christ's gift, rest upon and remain with them. These are prayers we ask and offer in Jesus' name. Amen. In Christ alone, my hope is found. So we may hear the cries looking for hope. So now receive the blessing of God. May the love of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and remain with you now and forever.